What happens if you crack your helmet in space? I gotta admit, floating aimlessly in space terrifies me, but it's illogical since I've never been to space. But since my brain is pretty creative, I catch myself thinking about what I'd do if that happened to me. And one of my options is simply to pop the helmet open. The problem with this idea is that it's even worse than it initially sounds. And not only is it worse, but many people are completely wrong about what happens. So if you want to know what really happens when you open your helmet in space, this video is for you.
Hey, Pedro here. This video you are watching was originally in Portuguese, my native language. This is the attempt of our team to translate it to English, and I sincerely hope you enjoy it. Your feedback is extremely important to us. Now, back to the video.
To start answering the video's question the right way, we first gotta understand a few things about space. And the first thing is, space isn't cold. This might sound off to some of you, especially if you've heard that space temperature is around negative 270 degrees Celsius. But this temperature isn't quite like the temperatures we're used to here on Earth. Whenever we talk about temperature, we are actually referring to how agitated the molecules of something are. The more agitated, the higher the temperature. The less agitated, the lower the temperature. And the key word here is molecules. Temperature is what we call a macroscopic measure, meaning it's like an average of how much energy the molecules making up that thing have. Everything within our reach here on Earth that has a temperature is literally swarming with molecules. Even the air, which you actually can't see, has billions upon billions of molecules. And what's the point I'm trying to make? Out in space, we barely have any molecules to even have a temperature. It's almost a perfect vacuum, and that's important because there are only three ways to exchange heat. Convection, conduction, and radiation. Convection is what's going down in your pot when you're cooking. The water below warms, swapping places with the cold water which stays on top. And this doesn't happen in space because it doesn't have molecules. Conduction happens when you touch a hot surface and it gives some of that thermal energy to you, sometimes causing burns in the process. This doesn't happen in space either because it doesn't have molecules. The only possible way to exchange heat in space is through radiation, which is the only way that doesn't require contact between matter. If you took a thermometer and put it out in space, you'd see it slowly drop in temperature until it hit that chilly minus 270 degrees Celsius we always hear about. But the reason this is happening is because the thermometer is slowly giving off radiation, which is invisible to us, and it's cooling down in the process. So, what's everyone's first mistake? Thinking you'd immediately freeze in space. That just doesn't happen. If you were teleported into space right now, you wouldn't instantly freeze but emit radiation gradually, cooling until you're at the same temperature as the universe, around minus 270 degrees Celsius. But here's a key thing. We've got the sun messing everything up. If any part of your body was out in the sun, it would get warmed up by the radiation emitted by our star, while the parts in the shade would cool down. To give you an idea of how problematic this is, the International Space Station, which completes a lap around the Earth every hour and a half, suffers temperature variations ranging from minus 120 degrees Celsius in the parts that are in the shade to 120 degrees Celsius in the parts that are exposed to the sun. The same thing would indeed happen to you if you were tossed out into space without a spacesuit. But the effect wouldn't be instant. It'd take a while for the part of your body in the sun to gradually warm up, just like it'd take a while for the part in the shade to slowly freeze. Basically, popping your helmet open in the vastness of space wouldn't feel precisely the same as dunking your head into a bucket of liquid nitrogen on the spot. But that doesn't mean we wouldn't experience instant sensations. Out of the more than 650 people who've been to space so far, only three have died up there, all three on the Soyuz 11 mission. The year was 1971, and the first space station in history, Salyut 1, was in low Earth orbit. A mission was set to dock Soyuz, the Soyuz 10, with the Salyut station at the start of the year. But the crew had to head back to Earth when the docking failed due to mechanical issues. Later in the year, a new mission with the same goal was launched, the Soyuz 11. The rocket was successfully launched from Baikonur, Kazakhstan on June 6, 1971. The next day, After a procedure that lasted 3 hours and 19 minutes, the Soyuz and the Salyut station were docked. The three crew cosmonauts, Dobrovolsk, Volkov, and Batsayev, spent a total of 22 days in orbit inside the station, smashing all the space duration records up to that point, until it was time to return home on June 29, 1971. After a decoupling procedure that went as planned, the ground base abruptly lost communication with the crew just before re-entering the atmosphere. The Soyuz 11 kept on its way back and 25 minutes later landed in Kazakhstan in what seemed like a totally normal re-entry procedure. The rescue team said there were no visible damages on the outside. The only weird thing is that after they knocked on the Soyuz's hull, they didn't hear any answers from the cosmonauts inside. The three cosmonauts were still sitting there in their usual spots, but they had bluish marks on their faces and a bit of blood was coming out of their noses and ears. The cause of death? Asphyxiation. An investigation set up to discover the cause of the accident found that the problem was a ventilation valve that was damaged during the re-entry procedure. The damaged valve left the cabin open to the vacuum of space at a height of 168 kilometers, removing all the air inside. All the cosmonauts were gone within 40 seconds. To date, they are the only three people to have died in space, above the Kármán line. I told this tragic story of Soyuz 11 to show that the main danger, at least for humans, of space travel is the pressure, which is zero in the vacuum of space. The three cosmonauts were exposed to the vacuum of space, but temperature wasn't even a factor considered in the investigations. They didn't make it precisely because of the pressure, or rather the distinct lack of it. The human body evolved to adapt to a specific environment, found right here on Earth. We are constantly being affected by atmospheric pressure, and once you take that out of the equation, we have problems. In the case of cosmonauts, exposure to vacuum of space caused the oxygen and nitrogen in their blood to form bubbles, bursting their veins. And this happened all over their body, but it was mainly a problem in their brain. But the craziest thing is, we know about this one person who got exposed to the vacuum of space and lived to tell the tale. Back in December 1966, NASA was busy testing out spacesuit prototypes. To do that, they used a huge vacuum chamber that can suck out all the air particles, simulating outer space conditions. And one of the engineers, Jim LeBlanc, was testing one of those suits inside the vacuum chamber. At one point during the test, the hose that kept the pressure inside the suit came loose, and 14 seconds later, LeBlanc passed out and fell flat on his back. Luckily, one of the other people who was also in the test managed to get into the chamber 25 seconds later and give LeBlanc some oxygen. And he, to this day, remains the only one who survived exposure to space's vacuum and lived to tell. And in his words, the last thing he remembers is the spit on his tongue bubbling and evaporating. He passed out right after that. So, to answer the question in the video, what happens if you open your helmet in space, you don't freeze instantly? As some movies show. Your body temperature remains stable for quite an extended stretch. The main problem with being in space without the protection of a suit is the vacuum. As soon as you get exposed to the vacuum of space, the gases in your blood start to bubble up, blocking your circulation and beginning to bust your veins. Most people would have 20, hopefully 40 seconds of consciousness. And a common estimate is that, once exposed to vacuum of space, a person has, on average, 90 seconds for recompression. Beyond that, death is inevitable. At the end of the day, space clearly wasn't designed for our survival. But we exist and thrive in it despite all that. The existence of an International Space Station, which stands as a symbol of cooperation among countries and has been continuously inhabited by humans for 23 years, also serves as a reminder of what humanity does best, which is adapting to live in the most unimaginable places. We didn't evolve to travel through space, land on the moon, or to put robots and eventually humans on other planets. But indeed, we do all of this, despite living in a universe that's especially hostile to life as we know it. And in a future that I truly hope is real soon, we'll be there. We'll be present on every moon, every planet, every single space that can be thoroughly studied within our solar system, our very own neighborhood among the myriad of stars. And we will discover many things. We will know the impossible, and we will forever leave our mark and our legacy among the stars. And that's why it's important to conquer even space. Thank you very much and see you next time.